welcome to the MBS Show, episode number 208. I am your host, Norman Sanzo. Joining me today is Will.
What's up?
How are you doing, man?
Oh, you know, the average life of an average person. Completely abnormal.
I see. So, probably people are wondering, where the hey are everybody? Well, sometimes life gets in the way and they're distracted with personal lives. And, well, they're busy doing stuff.
Yes, busy. Had nothing to do with me getting them all out of the way in the process.
Yeah, totally. Nothing.
No. Definitely not. Nothing malicious whatsoever.
But, Will, how are you doing, man?
In all honesty, feeling pretty good. It's springtime. The sun is out. The birds are singing. There's new episodes of MLP. There's new episodes of other cartoons that are awesome. All in all, it's just feeling like a really good springtime.
True. Will, we have a tradition on the show where I like to ask people who are new to the show the four important questions. And those questions are favorite character, favorite episode, how do you become a fan of the show, and what do family and friends think about your love for said show. So I think it's per tradition if we ask you this also.
All right, then. Let's get right into it.
All righty then. So question number one, favorite character.
Queen Chrysalis.
Queen Chrysalis. Wow, out of the gate.
Yeah, I just love unrepentant villains and or Disney villains, and I will admit I also love characters like I love the Xenomorphs. I love I cannot remember their name, but they're from Planescape. It's an old spaceflight simulator, but they are basically the big bad aliens from that thing, and they just remind me that them and the Xenomorphs and Chrysalis, just evil bug creatures as villains. I love those kind of characters because they're creepy, they're crawly, and they just, come on. What's not to love about emotivores? I mean, come on. They want to suck the love right out of you.
Yep. No comment. Like, no comment. I got no idea. Like, you got a really good answer there. Like, okay.
She's evil, her group is evil, and let's face it, they won. The only reason they didn't win in the end was because Deus Ex Love Machina.
True. I mean,
she was written so well, the writers had written themselves into a corner.
That is also true. But if you think about it, she was overconfident and cocky, and that got her.
Oh, yeah. That's the Disney villain aspect. It's like, overconfidence is their weakness. Your faith in your friends is yours.
All right. So, favorite episode then?
Favorite episode? Oh, gosh. That's really hard because, okay, if I had to pick one episode that I would use as the defining thing of MLP, it would have to be the Sonic Rainboom episode. I cannot remember what the title is off the top of my head. Season 1.
I think that could be, whatchamacallit, this Flight to the Finish, something like that.
I think that's Flight to the Finish.
People know. So that episode.
Yeah, the first time Rainbow Dash performs Sonic Rainboom saves Rarity. That was actually my first episode too. So to have that be the episode that hit all the buttons for me. It hit likable characters. It hit great action payoff climax. It hit good humor. Very good humor. And any staple I love of any cartoon. It had a character have a psychotic breakdown.
Okay. Personally, for me, when people say favorite episode would be Sonic Rainboom, and someone, I forgot who asked me this, or could be Dr. Wolf, but the person asked, like, if you were to introduce someone to a new episode, like someone new to a episode, what episode would you introduce them to? A few good answers was the Sonic Rainboom episode, or Art of the Dress, or so on, but they rebut with, okay, you do introduce them to the Sonic Rainboom episode, but that doesn't really tell them what's the whole story like. You just show them an episode with a character that's bossy, not confident in herself, and also you showed the worst of Rarity and so on.
Yeah, if I had to say an episode to show somebody, though, I would probably pick... Oh, gosh, I feel like such a bad fan. I can't remember the title names.
It's cool, man. I don't remember, too.
Discord's first two episodes.
Oh, The Return of Harmony, part 1 and 2.
Yeah, because it briefly shows the characters at their best, but it does show the villain power it has. It shows how the show can be a bit...
Dark,
but also fun. How it can be written very clever.
All right. That does make a good point in terms of what episode you showed someone for, well, to start off the show. That is a good one.
If I were to add on top of it, I will say that John DeLancey, just selling the role, usually gets a lot of the people I know to actually come over to it because they're like, oh, cool, this guy, yeah, I know what he does. And and I say, yeah, and if you keep watching the show, he actually starts appearing a lot more in later seasons. Well, how can he appear a lot more in the later seasons? I thought he was defeated. Okay, that's a bit of a spoiler, but yeah.
Yeah, you have to see. You have to see it for yourself.
See!
For me, my favorite episode was... There's a two-part to this. Like, I think Lesson Zero is one of them. But I kind of like Luna Eclipse. But Lesson Zero, just because of Twilight's breakdown, Tara Strong really sold that role.
Actually, did you notice how Spike in the newest episodes, the season premiere of season 6, Spike seems to be emulating a lot of Twilight with her manic abilities.
Twilight? Spike? Really?
Yeah, well, just like, hey, you better do this by the list. If we don't do this by the list, you can take a huge step forward instead of a huge step backward. Oh. And then everything would be failure. And then you'd actually be a complete and utter failure. There's nothing you can do about it.
No pressure at all.
Yeah. And then he just goes silent to saying, check, good thing we talked about that. It's like, you are a troll, Spike.
Yeah.
Okay, but as you were saying, okay, that we went way off there. Okay, third question.
How did you become a fan of the show?
Well, back in the day in 2000 and, 2010, 2011, yeah, 2011, in about January-ish, I was cruising the 4chans. I was actually a big, cruiser of, F, Flash.
Oh, okay.
Because I was big into Flash animation. So like, I would take people's, they'd post Flash documents there, and then I'd be like, okay, now I get to dissect this thing. How did this person make this animation? And usually it was anything from, to audio and video loops to clips of shows. And one particular one that started popping up a lot was actually clips and loops with audio of music of this cartoon show. And I'm just like, okay, these characters, I don't know where this is from, but hey, you know, I like the music that's going to the back. And then after a while, I started seeing them more pop up and like, okay, what is this from? And I, you know, you never really check the comments to anything because, you know, it's 4chan. Mm-hmm. So checked it out and people, you know, were talking about this show. And I'm like, huh, so they made a new My Little Pony. Okay. I was ambivalent. I was just like, great, so Hasbro updated their properties once again. Yes, I did grow up with Transformers Beast Wars.
Oh.
And, yeah, so that was my Transformers growing up. And, you know, a lot of Transformers had happened in the interim, like I think 6 or 7 different shows had happened since I was a kid. And I was just like, okay, so they decided to update MLP again. And then, you know, I started seeing people saying, yeah, the show's deceptively good, or they started making jokes about it, and I'm like, really? You know what? Why the heck not? I'll give this thing a shot. I'll just see what the heck everyone's talking about. And I watched it, and I was just like, huh, it's a decent cartoon. Okay, let's see what else they got on it. And because I just liked the cartoon, because it was decent and wasn't absolute tripe, I was just like, okay, let's see how this is going. Then I got up to episode 8 or whatever, just like the episode right after Rainboom, and I was like, oh, I really like this show. It's surprisingly dang good. So that's how I got into the cartoon. And I've just been watching it ever since, because I like good cartoons.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And that's the thing with MLP. It's a good cartoon. I think they focus on story first, then setting the products. So that what makes it good.
Actually, every time I see someone complain about a new edition or whatnot, like, okay, the whole Flurry Hearts, you know, previews and what, people are like, ah, oh, they're ruining Anakin's stories. They're ruining the lore. And I'm like, you guys do remember that they are literally ordered by Hasbro to include certain things in the show to sell them. The writers don't come up with these ideas to add characters or add stuff. They literally are working on the seat of their pants to come up with a story. Okay, we gotta include this. How do we do it in a way that will actually be good? And that they should be lauded for, because they're like the YouTube loading bar, having to lay down so much track ahead of you going fast. It's just like, oh crap, can we keep up?
One thing I love about the marketing that they try to do or try to sell is the balloon. Like, Hasbro wanted to sell their balloon. For whatever reason, it's the balloon. Remember that in season 1?
Oh, yeah, the twinkling balloon has to be everywhere.
Mm-hmm. You know what?
And it's still everywhere. Yeah. It's still in the title screen.
Yeah. So, like, yeah, you want to sell a balloon? There it is. You want to sell a train? There it is, in the very beginning of the intro.
Probably why the intro has not changed much. Although I do kind of love that, you know, season six started as like, okay, what's different about the season six intro? Nothing, nothing, nothing. Ooh, the Starlight Glimmer has self-inserted herself in the crowd. There she is.
Oh, no, before that one, like in season five, I think, Discord in the background.
Oh, yeah, Discord in the background. And then they did, like, a bigger change with, you know, like, now everybody's in the photo.
Yay. That's cool. But one of my favorite toy insert is the helicopter. Remember that one?
Oh, yeah, it was just a gag scene. Actually, that's probably the perfect thing they could have used it for was a gag scene.
Yeah, it's not really a gag. It's Twilight almost hitting into the helicopter and Rainbow Dash stopping her. It's like, oh, okay, that happened.
Yeah, better what? And then you're like, okay, so they have mastered lighter-than-air travel, and it seems to be a hobby.
Yeah, yep.
When you have an entire race that can just fly easily, you know, it's like...
Yeah, it's like, no point.
Though I would love to see more airships.
Oh, true that. But still, they haven't inserted the Applejack truck yet. So, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think they can actually get away with that.
No.
I mean, the technological level that we've kind of said is sort of like it's an anarchism stew of hodgepodge of everything. Like, they have electricity, they have electric dams. I think I've seen them use sockets on the walls, but not everyone has them. And they have plumbing, but not everyone has plumbing. And it's like...
It's confusing. Just look at Twilight's castle and ask yourself, what is even going on there?
Yeah, actually, that's the greatest thing if you really want to get into some headcanon territory is, okay, this entire castle was grown. Does that mean it also grew all the pipes and the internal workings and the circuitry? And if it grew, does that mean the castle itself is a living being? Does that mean it thinks, it feels? If that's true, then what if Spike decides to take a chomp out of it? Is he like a parasite leeching off the castle itself?
Oh, well, I don't think you'd go that far, but my answer for almost everything is, it's magic.
Yeah, don't question it. Yeah.
It's hard. Okay, I know people say, oh...
But it's fun. It's fun. That's the point of the whole, of the guesswork, is it's just fun to do. Sometimes taking things... Crap, now I'm taking a line from Josh Scorcher. Sometimes taking things too seriously is fun.
I know. There's a thing, like, if we really want to break down how equestrian society works in terms of technological advancement, we can spend hours on it, but nah, I'm not going to spend hours on talking something that I really don't know, and it's just only headcanon.
Now we will begin the long expose on working, how does Pinkie Pie hide everything around town in a time limit that actually makes sense.
Oh, black holes.
We will now begin this expose for 3 hours.
but anyway, last question is... What do your family and friends think about your Love for Sid show?
Close family just thinks, is not really surprised because I love cartoons and animation. Mm-hmm. That's really it. And friends, I don't have any friends. So I don't know what you're talking about. No. But basically all of my friends that I know are also animators and or cartoonists and or creative types. So many of them are either already into the show, passively know about the show. Anyone I know who's a friend is already involved or just knows about it and doesn't care.
All right. So basically they just accept it and moved on.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, great. Yeah. So how about them Knicks?
Yep. But true. Having people like that is awesome. And I bet most of your friends here know Lauren Faust. Like, she's one of the few that created the childhood for most kids in the early 90s or late 90s.
Yeah, there was a project involving cartoons. She was somehow involved in it. I didn't mean to say that was bad. I mean, that's great. It's just like, she was everywhere.
Yep, true. Like, for example, Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends, Powerpuff Girls, what else? Like, My Little Pony. And, well, it's been a while since she worked on the show, but she still has her headcanons, and recently, she kind of blurred out what she thinks. And the topic is love.
Yeah, well, we know what happened last time when she started talking about pony farts.
Yep.
This is going to be a wild ride, ain't it?
Yep. But this is one of those things where, hey, fanfic writers, go wild.
Well, they already do. This is like throwing kerosene onto a fire.
Yeah. There's a few that I like. Here, Twilight's true love was meant to be an earth pony named Stud Muffin. His cutie mark is a dumbbell.
Oh, gosh. I have seen a lot of responses to this. I even saw Silver Quill's response to this, where it's implied that Flash Sentry and Clutterstep murder him.
Oh.
It's okay, Twilight. He's in a better place away from us.
Oh, here's one about Pinky. Was Pinky meant to have a true love? Cough, cheese sandwich, cough. And Laura's answer is, nope, Pinky's eventual true love would be a chocolate mousse. It's an interspecies relationship.
Okay. Well, Pinky does love baked goods, so...
Indeed.
Didn't think you could really love baked goods that much.
But that's Pinky. What about Fluttershy? Well, someone asked what Fluttershy's true love could be, and... Lauren's answer for this one is just trolling to the max. Nobody. Fluttershy just ends up with a lot of cats. So she's the crazy cat lady.
Actually, that isn't really that far from a stretch of the possibility, because you gotta really think about it. She already keeps a whole bunch of pets. Having a whole bunch of cats is not beyond the realm of possibility with that one.
Yeah, true that. And what about Rarity? Rarity seems awesome. Someone asked, does Rarity find the prince she dreamed of? And yeah, Lauren's answer is yes, 5 times. 5 princes, 5 divorces.
Yeah, that describes probably what happened to Rarity. She would become, what is that? It's like, bah. Yeah, Rarity's love life would be something out of a soap opera.
Yeah.
And everybody has amnesia.
Oh, God. And knowing the business-savvy Rarity, she'll have a prenup where she gets everything.
That actually kind of makes me hate her now, then, if she does, because now she sounds like a... I ain't saying she's a gold digger, but she ain't messing with no broke.
What about Rainbow Dash? We all know the Rainbow Dash, right? So, someone asks... So does Rainbow Dash like mares, or do the Stallion have a chance? Lauren's answer is, Rainbow Dash one and only true love is herself.
Yeah, the ego on that one, but oh, the implications from that. It's just like, so the only way she can actually truly find love is if she loves herself. Okay. Hey Twilight, do you know a cloning spell?
Oh, that's a mirror pun.
Yeah, it goes to the mirror pool, and then she lives happily ever after.
Oh God. There's AG, I don't know what to say. Someone asked, please tell me AG marries Bloomberg. Ain't Bloomberg the tree?
Can't marry a tree.
But Lauren's answer is, AG revives an old family tradition and joins a controversial marriage herd. She has 12 husbands and 37.
Well, you know what the fandom always says about her apple bucking hips.
yep.
Oh. Yeah, but then to which marriage herd. Wow, that is already been done to death in fan fiction.
I know.
And to which I'm just going to say off the bat, it doesn't make much sense. I mean, it was made out of someone's attempt to try and explain the gender disparity between the characters. Like, say, oh, well, they have herds and whatnot. And then we started seeing a lot more. That was only because it was season one and season two. Once season three started happening, we started seeing a lot more Stallion characters, and it seems to be split 50-50 down the line anyway. So the point is, the whole herding thing was originally out of someone's, oh, well, this makes sense because, you know, it's horse stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well, kind of. But still, in season 6, I seen a lot of more Stallions on the show. So they're balancing it out slowly.
Yeah. The long story short, that is a plot that has to stay in fan fiction. Yes. And only in bad fan fiction.
Oh, good.
Bad.
That's not a word.
Fan fiction.
No. there's a lot more. There's a lot more from Lawrence. Lauren's answer are just insane. I could read more, but you know what? I'm just going to let you guys read it because it's just awesome. Okay, I got one more because this is just so much fun. What happens to Princess Luna? I got to know. Lauren's answer is, Luna marries Batman. They are the knight.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, I got to find that one. I got to find that one because I have to save it myself.
Yeah, it's all in the link in the show notes. So if you want to go look at Hijinx answers and other good stuff like is there. There's Celestia, there's Luna, there's Sombra, there's Mrs. Cake, Chrysalis, and yeah, there's a lot more. Like, just go there, take a look-see, and it's just so much fun. And it's just all a joke from Lauren. And this was before April Fool's. Still, much fun though.
Very cool.
Mm-hmm. But out of all those questions, there was one serious one asked by a fan asking, what happened to Scootaloo's family?
People have always, you know, said, it's like, oh, well, we never see her parents.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you think about it, we don't see them at all. Out of all the 6 seasons, we only see her home. That's about it.
But it looks like a home and not a foster home, so she isn't an orphan.
Mm-hmm. Lauren's answer here is totally acceptable. They both have demanding jobs, and Scootaloo is good at evading her babysitter.
Yeah, you try chasing after a kid who can move that fast on a scooter.
Yep.
I'm pretty sure after the 4th time, the babysitter was just like, ah, sod it, I'm going back to the house.
Yep. But still, this is one of those answers where I can accept it, I can dig it. I think Lauren had more to say about it. But still, those one of those mysteries where I think this is an acceptable answer for Scootaloo.
It works a lot better. Then it just leaves it open to eventually introducing those characters down the line if they ever have a reason to.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You, me, we're rational people. We don't jump the gun and say, oh my god, what happened to her parents?
Oh, hey, now, calling me a rational person, I think you might be overstepping your bounds there, buddy.
Don't call me buddy, friend.
Call me friend, guy.
I can't believe I got a chance to do that. This is how silly we are.
Okay, but yeah, so it works great. I mean, it fills it in well. Other show members said that they liked the idea as well, and they'll try to keep it true. And, well, okay, so now we have at least a near-canon story of why Scootaloo's parents are never seen. Now I want to have an episode with a beleaguered babysitter just like, dang it, Scootaloo, I'm trying to take care of you. Please stop running away.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like one of those cases where, okay, we got a setup. Scootaloo is really sneaky and she evades babysitter. And suddenly we get one babysitter who got hired to babysit Scootaloo. And that babysitter is Rainbow Dash.
Oh, well, then she'd probably have no problem with it. But then again, Rainbow Dash having responsibility.
We'll see. Because if that works and if that happens, it will be awesome.
We already did get a preview of what the first Rainbow Dash episode of this season looks like.
I haven't seen anything
yet. I'm not going to spoil what it said, the description said, mm-hmm. But it does look like it's going to be interesting.
Oh, wow. I haven't seen anything. Like, no spoilers, no nothing. Like, I'm going in blind.
It's episode 7, I believe.
Yeah.
So, we got a couple weeks mm-hmm. until we see it, but...
Yeah, but still. And talking about hit cannons and stuff, like, ever since Season 6, Episode 1 and 2 came out, people have been talking about alicorns and how do they exist and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And interestingly enough, Imitating Rogers had an idea of, well, I won't say had an idea, it was kind of what she thought it was going to be like. And to summarize everything, according to what she thinks.
Yeah, and she was the writer behind the Journal of the Two Sisters, mm-hmm. so... She's already written heavily about alicorns, so this would be her idea of, or at least her understanding of how alicorns work.
Yeah, and it's sanctioned by Hasbro. That book was sanctioned by Hasbro, so it's considered canon. And according to what she says, like, Celestia and Luna were the firstborn alicorns in known history. She hasn't watched the premiere and don't know why people are freaking about the whole thing. I think it's what Celestia said, like, something to do with born alicorns, nothing in history. Like, what are you two then? What else? She's not a writer, but Equestria was founded and Celestia and Luna became the princesses. So I think was founded by Starshoulder Bearded and Co., which is Princess Platinum, Commander Firebrand, Hurricane, and who else?
Commander Firebrand. Wow, yeah, wrong person, buddy.
Sorry.
Yeah. Josh Scorcher is responsible for the creation of Equestria. You're just feeding into his ego now, buddy.
Wrong person. I should feed the hippogriff. And, like, those three, and then I think they got Celestia and Luna to become princesses.
More like probably it's just like, holy crap, what are they? I don't know, I think they're alicorns or something. Wow, they got all the powers. We should totally let them do the job. Yeah, super powerful people doing the super powerful job. Do the job, please. They're like, okay. Then they became princesses.
Yay. But to summarize, Equestria is founded with Starswirl and Co. Celestia and Luna are asked to be princesses of the newly founded Equestria, and they have been princesses for a very, very long time. During that long time, no natural-born alicorns were born. Celestia and Luna did not have foals. So, having said that, it's logical why they don't have any alicorns besides Flurryheart.
Yeah, and then again, if you also look at genealogy, I mean, Twilight Sparkle's whole family, I mean, Nightlight and Twilight Velvet, it just seems like the lineage that those two have made have led to some very super powerful ponies. I mean, we got Shining Armor, who just has the best kind of shield spells, able to project over an entire city and whatnot. And then we have their own kid, Twilight, who became an alicorn through, you know, studious work and understanding of the magic of friendship. And then we have, you couple that lineage with another Pegasus, Cadence, who became an alicorn through her own striving work. I'm totally blanking on what she did. But
I think what Cadence did was there was some kind of chaos in her village, and the witch or something like that had some kind of gemstone making
people. Yeah, and
people
she purified it
yeah,
somehow.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Well, but basically, she did that. She became an alicorn. So you combine Twilight's side of the family's lineage with Cadence's own, you know, ascension, and you basically almost have a recipe for some superpowered being born because of it. So, eugenics! Hooray!
Yeah, and according to Mr. Cake of how pony genetic works, it's just crazy. An earth pony has a pegasi and a unicorn for a kid. How?
Because of very, very in the past family members on both sides of the family, remaining genetics. Of course, genetics don't exactly work that way, and, you know, Mr. Cake wasn't exactly, well, his shifty eyes, but I don't think the show really wants to talk about anything else.
Yeah. Oh, but still, that was much fun, yo.
But then again, you know, even if that really is how genetics works for ponies, because, you know, magic, then, geez, you just have a hodgepodge of, it's basically just like, it's like spinning a wheel at The Price is Right. It's like, okay, make it land on 100. You make it land on 100, you get an alicorn baby. Yeah! Deet, 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 5 cents.
You get an earth pony. Aww.
But the whole board is practically 5 cents. We know.
I think it could be, whose line is it anyway? Where the point don't matter?
Yeah, it just does not matter. It's like, you have a kid? Well, roll the dice. You're gonna get a pegasi, and you're gonna get a unicorn, and you're gonna get a horrible abomination of magic and science.
Oh, that's just weird science.
You know, the show itself has not covered if crossbreeding is possible. You know, like when we have fan characters who are hippogriffs or draconies, or they haven't really covered that in the show. Probably because, you know, there's no reason, because they don't have, they're not told. They're probably told not to create new species or whatnot because of merchandising reasons.
Hippogriff is not out of the norm. It's basically, in terms of modeling or in terms of building a flesh character, it's just splicing out the back end of the cat into a horse and keeping the eagle front.
Yeah, but again, we haven't seen anything of like that in the show yet, so who knows? Who knows? I mean, we've had alicorns born now, so who knows? They could just go in the whole species line. I'm personally hoping for pony changeling hybrids.
It's on that one. Like, that's just going to be too complicated. But I do want to see a Kirin. Basically, Kirin is a horse dragon.
Ooh, a horse dragon. That would be cool.
Yeah, so that's going to be interesting.
Or we could get a Medusa, and it's literally just a snake with a pony's head.
Medusa is technically the name. I think you're thinking of a Naga?
A naga. Yeah, that'd be cool. Just like, hiss! You are the most adorable thing ever. No, I'm a ferocious naga! Hiss!
We'll see. But, well, those are the news for this week. And, well, news for this week has been really interesting because I think we play on a lot of hit cannons.
Yeah, the fan fiction writers are going to have a field day with this week, and the fan community is going to be, like, pumping out new theories and new ideas of what all this new information could be. And then people will, some will cry that, no, their headcanons are now ruined, but those people can honestly just continue to cry in a corner to themselves because, come on, man, if you're a writer and you're suddenly complaining about, oh no, this one thing is a problem, it's just like, then don't ever work for DC and Marvel, because the canon in there is so screwed up.
Well, talking about canons and whatnot, Josh Haber, a writer for the show, recently tweeted this, confession time, the speck in the sky in the premiere is, get this, M.A. Larson. He comes to Equestria to marry, then divorce every pony.
Of course.
Yep.
M.A. Larson, on the way to go break hearts.
Yep. And I'm not even joking. This is true. This tweet is true.
Well, if it's true, then it's canon. M.A. Larson off to go destroy some hearts in the Crystal Empire.
Thanks, M.A. Larson.
But you do have to admit, though, I caught that speck. My mind first said, wait a second, what's that speck doing there? Mm-hmm. Just out of place. And then you think about it, there are no real Pegasi in the Crystal Empire. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's probably a couple that are guards, but Every crystal pony is technically just an earth pony with a crystally shine. Doesn't mean anything, and everyone's just overthinking it, then, okay, it was just a gag there thrown by the people. But if it actually is them hinting at something towards the future, I have to give them props for doing, you know, background stuff for, you know, fans to find.
Yeah. For me personally, when I saw that, here's the thing, in my head, I don't know why, but I thought that was Dr. Wily.
Yes, Mega Man! Now I will allow you to get the Robot Masters with crystal power!
The only reason why I think that is because I've been playing the Mega Man collection on the 3DS. And every time when I play that game, like, okay, near the end, I see Dr. Wily flying off. Like, okay. And when I see that episode, it's like, what is that, Dr. Wily? But still... the spec is something, well, it's M.A. Larson. Let's go roll with it.
Oh yeah, let's roll with it, yeah. Well, that means M.A. Larson is also a changeling, because someone did the win all CSI on the thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Zoom in, enhance, tilt.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, but
this fandom is just nuts, and that's why I love it.
Yeah, people will just come up with the craziest stuff, and people will eat up the craziest stuff.
Oh, tell me about it, man. Like, I've been watching a lot of Gravity Falls, and I talk about crazy.
Oh, yeah, that cartoon was great, and actually, I'm kind of glad it ended. Mm-hmm. It ended on a good... I personally thought it just ended the story perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing ends perfectly, but it ended the story well, and I think that's actually kind of good for a lot of shows to have a definite end. Because with a definite end, that means the story is closed on there, and you can leave the rest to fan supposition, but then you can move on to a new story.
Mm-hmm. And if I do remember right, it was all according to Alex's plan, where with the whole story, Disney gave him the money, or wanted to give him the money for third season, and he said, no, I don't want to, the story's done. But he didn't say that he won't use those characters in another story.
The story of Gravity Falls could be over, but that doesn't mean the characters themselves don't have other adventures.
Yeah, so basically we could expect more. And talking about that, MLP, even if it's done, I do hope they kind of expand on the sub-characters like the CMCs.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think there was actually even an idea to make this, to have the CMC have their own show, and the show would actually be aimed towards preschoolers.
Yeah, no. No,
I think I remember reading.
Yeah,
about that
I remember that too. I remember that too. But no. You had the problem with the CMCs about their voice actors getting older, and you want them to do a preschool show? No.
We don't need more Dora the Explorers.
Yeah, Dora the Explorer. I think Discovery has their niche in what they have now, because it's teen to preteens. So that's your target audience there.
Now I just like someone to, I just wish corporations would, you know, have the guts to back it. And just, I wish there were more cartoons that were being made American side that were aimed towards older audiences. And I don't mean the Family Guys. I don't mean the, whenever someone says adult animation cartoons, they tend to go towards the lowest hanging fruit of, oh, Simpsons. Family Guy or Simpsons or
American Dad.
Oh yeah. The Fox stuff or like, anything from Adult Swim. Like stoner comedy and whatnot. I'm just like, no, can we just have a show that has greatly written characters, has a good amount of action to it, has an adventure to it, maybe even, has a definite end of maybe 1 to 2, maybe 3 seasons, and follows a whole story and actually is competently well written, but has a storyline that is something you probably would not show your 8-year-old.
Mm-hmm. Well,
but the problem with it is that, you know, you got so much of the public consciousness that cartoons are only for kids.
I don't think so anymore. Like, having people say that cartoons are just for kids now, like early in the late 90s, early 2000s, I can believe so, because cartoons are just strange, or anime is just strange, because you could see ninja, what's that ninja show called? I forgot, Ninja something?
Ninja Gaiden? That's a game.
No, not Ninja Gaiden. It's something ninja, like Marco. It's a very gory ninja show.
Oh, the anime movie Marco the Ninja?
Something like that. I forgot, but it's a ninja show, and it was placed right beside some cartoon show. And just because that ultraviolet show is a cartoon doesn't mean it's kid-friendly.
No, but again, even though it may not be totally ingrained in some or most of the public consciousness, we're still talking about studio. We're still talking about corporations here or producers that they won't really, I mean, even now when stuff is brought over from other places, like anime or, you know, French cartoons that are brought over and they have anything that is remotely, you know, different, they tend to censor it or change the subject matter. I mean, heck, we don't have to talk about how much the Pokemon fandom gets in an uproar about how much they change on Pokemon, and that's like a very kids-friendly show, but no, they have to change rice cakes to donuts.
I think that's localization. But personally, when you talk about French cartoon, I just remember one show called Miraculous Ladybug.
That's been blowing up. I've been seeing a lot about that one.
Yeah, and it's a pretty good show. Funny story about that one is it's created in France, animated in Korea, and has something to do with the Japanese Toei company, and is showing on Disney and Nickelodeon. So, yeah, that is a very interesting show.
And that is the combination of so many different countries.
Yep.
Yeah, the biggest French cartoons that I can remember off the top of my head, because I don't see a lot of foreign cartoons, mainly just because I only go what comes easiest to me to find. Mm-hmm. But I do remember Wakfu.
Yeah, I remember them.
And also Code Lyoko. And Code Lyoko was probably the first one I saw, because that was localized and put on Cartoon Network, on their, like, Toonami group and whatnot, or Muguzi or whatever they were trying to do.
Before that, in the Disney Channel, they have Martin Mysteries.
Don't remember that one.
Remember? That one was kind of... Oh, if you don't remember that one, what about Totally Spies?
Yes, I do remember Totally Spies.
But
yes.
I'm not sure if that's pure French or French-Canadian.
French-Canadian. Probably. Sorry, every time I hear that, all I can think about is Titanic music.
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, all right.
That's what people heard as the Titanic sank. They didn't hear "Near My God to Thee" by the band. No, they heard some French Canadian mermaids singing.
Oh God, no! Oh God, no! But still, cartoons are everywhere, and most of the cartoons are done in Canada for budget reasons.
Oh yeah, I just would like it if something became popular, or at least became more well known, that did not go to the lowest hanging fruit of dumb adult humor that, you know, just, you know, swear words and fart jokes. Mm-hmm. And
yeah, it's the easy way out.
Being disgusting is like saying, if being disgusting is your determination of being an adult, then you're pretty immature.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay, my ultimate idea, why not have a cartoon that deals with a detective having to search the grimy inner city area, and he encounters a bunch of supernatural stuff, and it gets pretty heavy. You know, something like Harry Dresden-ish, all right? Those are some pretty dark books. But make it an animation, because doing it in 2D animation when it comes to the special effects would be cheaper than hiring out a bunch of 3D effects groups.
Yeah, true, but then you have those people who think that it's cartoon, then you have the whole debate of people don't like it because it's cartoon, people like it because it's cartoon, blah blah blah, and you have the argument of why couldn't they do this in real human thingies but instead of cartoon. Then yeah, like, if the content's good, the content's good. And talking about good content, if I do remember right, Netflix is going to be showing Voltron, like a reboot version of Voltron, if I remember right.
Oh, wow. I mean, the heck, you know, when you think about it, Netflix has actually become their own publishing house with, I would say at least an 80% or higher hit rate of good shows. I mean, some are obviously not always going to be great, but just from what I've seen, when it says, you know, Netflix original series, it tends to be interesting.
Promising.
Well, usually. I mean, there's been some that are just like, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
You ever seen Sense8?
No, I haven't heard of it. Like, that's how bad it is.
Oh, well, no, it's good. I liked it. I personally liked it. Loved the idea. Okay, basically, long story short, 8 people from around the globe suddenly, one day, gain a psychic connection to one another, meaning they can experience the other person's life in real time, and or even take control of the other person if they're in danger. Mm. Like a person who's a mafia hitman in Great Britain.
Mm-hmm.
He's from the Irish mafia. He actually helps a guy who he's psychically connected to in Africa fend off a whole gang. He just, you know, kicks their butts. it's kung fu stuff, and he does that because he's psychically connected to him. And you know, it has the whole season goes through why are they all connected? How does this affect? And it has 8 different stories being said at the same time, and most of them are really well written. Only downside I'd say to that show is it has definitely earned its M rating for a reason.
All right.
And not all the good reasons, but that's what I'm saying. You know, Netflix has a bunch of interesting stories, and now by you saying Voltron reboot, wow, okay, so they could start actually having their own cartoons and whatnot, or you know, animation projects specifically to Netflix,
mm-hmm.
And that would be interesting to have a publishing house like that, because, well, one, you wouldn't have to worry about runtimes always around commercials.
Mm-hmm.
You could focus more on the story, and because it's Netflix and everything is released all in one go, you don't have to have a plot an episode.
Yep, and if I do remember right, the trailer for Voltron is out there if you take a look-see. If I remember right, they're also doing a Star Wars something with Netflix. Something to do with Darth Maul?
Clone Wars or Rebels?
No, this is a Netflix exclusive.
Ooh.
Something to do with Darth Maul, if I remember right.
Oh.
So, yeah, that's there. I don't know when the timeline is, but it's there. So, this is pretty interesting.
Darth Maul.
Yeah.
Didn't die getting cut in half.
You thought he was dead, but have you seen Rebels?
Yeah. Didn't like Obi-Wan or say something just like, I liked you better when you were pieces.
I don't know what, but he...
Oh, no, wait, you know, he said, nice new legs.
Oh, when was that? Because I haven't seen that. Like, the one I saw was him being there, teaching the guy to do something. Like,
yeah, with Netflix having this idea of just original content to cartoons, it's going to be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, have you seen Knights of Sidonia?
I've heard of it, no.
Yeah. Interesting concept, kind of gets bogged down in some anime tropes that, you know, the classic anime tropes that you're like, does this really need to be in here? You know, that sort of stuff. But, I mean, I thought it was a unique idea. So, yeah.
Like, the show that you mentioned before, what was it called again?
I've mentioned a lot. The Wakfuku?
No, the one where people are psychically linked.
Oh, Sense8. Sense8. Yeah.
That show name is pretty not catchy, but...
Oh, it's literally SCNSE8. as in the number 8.
Yeah, so it's like, lead speak, not catchy at all. But in terms of concept...
Oh, what are you talking about? Lead speak is the greatest thing... I'm speaking, you can't see lead speak. Okay.
But...
Well, I'm typing out lead speak to you right now, all right?
Yeah, but anyway, the concept sounds awesome, and I really don't mind watching it because, well, I like the concept. Oh, God, you're really typing it, aren't you? For Suri. Oh, God.
I remember the early days of Tribes Gaming, and that was a haven for lead speak.
Well, anyway, we've been talking for about an hour now, and well, I think we covered almost everything.
We're going out on the greatest subject of lead speak.
Oh God, yeah, why not, right?
Pwned.
Oh God, no. Anyway, thank you, Will. So, if you guys have any questions, concerns, or suggestions for the show, you can contact us at mbshow@gmail.com. You can also reach us on the Twitters. StudyBot can be reached at the MBS Show. She'll tweet about this show, retweet this show, and, well, if you talk to her, she'll talk to you. And you also can catch me at Norman Sanzo. I tweet about toys, food, and whatever tickles my fancy. Currently tickling my fancy is The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess HD with the Wolfling Amiibo. Yay! I just bought that, and I really enjoy it.
It's adorable.
What about you, Will? Where can the people find you?
If people want to find me... They can find me at the furthest lengths of the greatest river and... Okay, now seriously. If you guys want to find anything of mine, all you really have to do is search for WILIZIN. I have DeviantArt, I have FimFiction, and those are the two most common things. Is Will Eisen on DeviantArt and Will Eisen on FimFiction. I also have a Tumblr, but, you know, no one talks about that.
Aww.
No. As it goes, you can find stories and art there.
Alrighty then. If I'm not mistaken, you're starting on YouTube?
Yeah, but nothing yet, so what we won't discuss it. I mean, heck, if you have me back and I actually have some stuff out to show, then I'll advertise it. But as for right now, the only thing that exists on that is a very, very bad Let's React.
Yeah. No problem.
And, come on. No one wants to see that. No one wants to see that stuff.
Some people do. No, but I do like the concept of what you're trying to do, and I hope you do it so I can have you back, man.
Oh, definitely. And I hope I will be able to surprise your audience as well.
Yeah, even if you don't do it, please come back.
Oh, I don't know. I'll just have to see if my schedule's open. And oh, the entire calendar's blank. I guess it is.
Anyway, and also please subscribe and rate us on iTunes, YouTube, and Stitcher Radio, and also like our Facebook page. You can also catch us on ponyforlife.com. Links will be in the show notes. So, I have been Norman Sanzo.
And I'm Will Eisen.
And we'll catch you guys next week with another fun episode of the MBS Show. We'll catch you guys next week. Bye-bye.
Have a great day, folks.